We probably went too fast, but that's okay. I mean, it's not like I did any damage to you all mentally. Over the course of the next 4 days, we are in review mode. For Andrew, those are the nicest things you've said in a long time. Yes, we are in full-on review mode. I have nothing new to teach to anybody in the room or watching it at home. There's no, like, what are you really saying? I'm saying I have nothing new to teach anybody. Okay, Giselle, you can, like, take your legal brain and stop looking for loopholes. I have nothing new to teach you. What we do have is 4 days to get really good, especially with Polar. This is a whole new world for you all. And there's just a lot of crazy stuff that's happening. So there's that. Now, what's really going to happen this week is Wednesday, you have a take-home quiz that's going to cover parametrics and Polar that you're going to do. It's going to take like 30 minutes. You're going to bring it into me on Thursday. I'm going to score it. I'm going to give you some feedback. We're going to review in class. David, you with me here?
Yes.
Because on Thursday, you have a take-home test that's due on Friday. And then on Friday, we actually start the final. No, that was a lie. Sorry. We start the next unit in BC, which is series. I will tell you, this is the make or break unit. If you thought things were hard before, you have been lying to yourself. Series is when things get way fun. Like, way fun and I'm like crazy. Ooh. Like, this is the one unit every year I need to review before I teach it, because it doesn't just come naturally. I need practice. You guys are going to get plenty of time. Plenty of time. Another reminder, AP Summit is happening this Saturday at the East End campus. Is anybody planning on going to this one?
No.
Andrew, you're going to this one?
That'd be BC.
No. The BC one is April 8th. There's an AB Summit this coming Saturday, March 25th, and then there's another AB Summit Saturday, April 1st. And you could go to any one of those two, and then still go on April 8th. And I think everyone's going on April 8th, but some of you maybe go on March 25th or April 1st. What I needed to let you know about the March 25th summit this Saturday, I'm not going to be there. Okay, so let me just quick explanation about why. I know I told you I was going to be there, and I do not go back on my word on things lightly. But a family member of ours was on hospice care before spring break, meaning like we knew like things were going in a particular direction. We drove to St. Louis, we spent time with him. On the way back, we got a phone call that he passed away. And so we're flying back this Saturday for the memorial service, and I can't really say to my wife and my family, oh, I can't go, I gotta go teach God's children. Although, there was a little temptation to be like, I can't! But I found somebody to cover my session, so everything's going to be well. All right, so here's what I want to do. We are going to go back into the world of Polar. Apparently the document camera's having a little bit of a challenge. Before we do that, I want you to find in your notes whatever notes you have on Polar. There was a summary sheet that we did. Hey, it's right there. Giselle's got it on page 27 of all the important Polar facts that you need to know. Give your brain a couple of minutes, go over it, ask me any questions that you have, study with somebody near you, and then we're gonna hit this for real. We get 3, we get 6, we get 10. Page 27. Where's your truck?
The apartment.
Okay. At least you know where all the things are.
I would make sure that you're really comfortable with the transformation formulas, that you know all four derivatives and what they're telling you. And that area formula. Good news, you don't, I know. The good news is that you don't have to derive the area formula we did when we had the conversation about the sectors and the little wedges. You don't need to derive it. You have to be able to use it, though. And even better news, Lewis, most of the time, you actually get to use your calculator when it comes to polar questions. Because for the most part, teenagers don't know a lot about what polar curves look like. So this is a good thing. Welcome, even among like the best and brightest in the world of polar, we're not so good. All right, so let's look at this example. Find the area bounded by one petal of the four petal rows, r equals 4 cosine 2 theta. There once was a time where calculus students needed to know that it was a four petal rose and that you'd be able to sketch it by hand. That is not the case. In part A, all that you need to be able to do is tell me how we're going to find the area. I want one petal of this four petal rose. So, what do we need to do? Well, we need to know that the area formula says the area is 1/2 r squared d theta from theta equals alpha to theta equals beta. If you don't like alpha and beta, use A and B, it doesn't matter. Okay? So there are some things here that we know and some things here that we don't know. What do we know? We know what r is. We know that r is 4 cosine 2 theta. Good. So we're going to do an integral of 4 cosine 2 theta squared d theta. And you're going to do that on your calculator. You're going to let your calculator do all the work. What don't we know? You don't know the limits of integration, the a and the b, the alpha and the beta. What you need to remember in the world of polar, the angle, whenever we talk about a point, we talk about it as like r comma theta. Theta is the angle that you make with the positive x-axis. R is the distance that you are running. I always think about it as windshield washers, right? Like here's my angle. At theta equals 0, how long is the radius? How long is that radius at theta equals 0? You've got the graph in front of you. How long is the radius of theta equals 4? It has a length of 4. Now, if you weren't 100%, like one way you could do it, you could like count the spaces, but there's another way that you should be able to get the 4. You know that r equals 4 cosine 2 theta. If theta is equal to 0, 2 times 0 is 0, cosine of 0 is 1. Okay? So now some people might say, all right, so my lower limit of integration is going to be theta equals 0. And some of you are already like, I don't feel so good about this. If you start at theta equals 0, what's the problem? I want to get some hands on this. What's the problem starting at theta equals 0? Carmen, what's the problem?
That we have to go a full rotation until it goes back to 0.
If you start at theta equals 0, what I hear you say is you have to do a full rotation until you get back over to here. Okay, so that's like part of the problem. If I start here, think about what happens. All these little sectors, they start at theta equals 0, and you're going to find the areas of all of those sectors.
We don't find the whole petal.
But you don't get the whole petal. Now, some of you might think, well, that's not actually a problem, because there's some clever math that you can do here. You can multiply by 2, right? You can use symmetry arguments, right? This petal is symmetric with respect to the x-axis. So maybe you're not so worried about starting at 0. Great. What you absolutely have to worry about, though, is where do you end? Where do you end the integration? And this is where you need to think really clever in the world of polar. Why would you stop integrating? What would have to happen with the radius for you to stop integrating? Where is it that you're trying to get to? You want to get this whole petal here, right? At least this top half. Mm-hmm. So what angle would you stop at?
Yeah.
Do you go all the way to pi over 2?
No.
No, because now you're up here in this pedal. You've got to figure out where do you stop. And the way that you would figure out where do you stop is think about the radius. Why would you stop rotating that angle? What would happen with the radius for you to say, oh, I'm supposed to stop here?
Reach to 0.
And what has to happen is that the radius shrinks down to be 0. Right? You've got to think about that windshield wiper. You're going up this way. But as the angle's increasing, the radius gets shorter, 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 and you get over here. And so the question that you need to ask is, when does the radius equal 0? So if I have 4 cosine of 2 theta is my radius, well, where's that equal to 0? Well, that happens if cosine of 2 theta is equal to 0. Where is cosine equal to 0? If you guys had taken pre-calc with me last year, I would have shown you like the cover-up method. I'd just say, forget about the angle for a second. Where's cosine equal to 0? At pi over 2, which means that 2 theta is going to be pi over 2, which means that theta is pi over 4. And maybe for some of you that are like really good with the trig, and if you were just going to guess where does the radius become 0, probably pi over 4 would be a good guess, halfway between 0 and pi over 2. Okay? But I want to be super careful here. This is not the answer. And why wasn't this the answer again? If you're starting at theta equals 0, that gets you half the pedal. So if you really want to get the true area, you're going to have to take this guy here and double it. And that would give you the area for the full pedal. You're saying, give me this one half, and now let me double it. Just take a minute, plug it in the calculator. You don't have to integrate it by hand. The hard part is going to be the limits of integration. Calculator's in the backpack, too. Good thing my calculator's in my backpack, which is in the back of my calculator. One half, you're integrating from 0 to pi over 4, 4 cosine 2 theta squared, the whole thing. So that's what you get for a number. You get 2. Anybody else getting 2?
2.
2. It just doesn't feel right?
Yeah. It's good.
Wait.
2's too pretty?
Oh, wait, no, I didn't cover it.
6.28?
Yeah, that's what I got.
6.28.
Yeah, 2.
Hopefully there's a little more than
6.28.
6.282 or 6.283. You might recognize that number. It's a really special number for us, not pi squared.
2 pi.
Okay, everybody good? All right, now here's the thing. I am pretty confident that like if you remember the formula, we can figure out the limits of integration and we can get here. I have seen, however, the AP exam ask the question a different way. What they'll say is, how could you set up the integral expression? And some calculus students are going to get really clever and see it this way. Any other setups that we could use? Stephen, what do you say?
Negative pi over 4 to pi over 4.
Okay, so 1 half the integral from theta equals negative pi over 4 to pi over 4, 4 cosine 2 theta squared d theta. Does that work?
Yes.
Right, you're going from negative pi over 4, which is going to be like down here, all the way up to positive pi over 4. That would get you the full pedal. Love it. Any other ideas? Any other ways the College Board might hide this from you? Lewis?
You take out the 1 half and 2.
Take out the 1 half.
From the first one we did.
Oh, from this first one, right? They get rid of the 1 half and they say, oh, this 1 half and those 2, they get multiplied together. I'm not even going to write it. Love it. So that's another way the College Board could hide this from you. Any other thoughts about how they're going to hide this from you? And if they don't hide it from you, I will. What other integral setups could they do to mess with your brains?
Oh.
Yes, ma'am.
How
would they change the limits of integration?
Since like they're all equal, they go from prior to prior to.
What's the all that are equal? I don't mean really picky. The petals have the same area. You don't have to focus on this petal over here. You can focus on this one, this one. Any of the petals. Lots of ways to jack with your brains. Everybody okay? All right, we're good. We got this. All right, so now with all that said, let's just do some new stuff. I'm going to turn on the calculator in just a little bit. If you guys go over to page 31, I love this problem. I put it together with love and kindness for you all. This problem's got everything. This is what every day this week is going to feel like. Everything's going to get mixed in together. Your goal in the next couple of minutes, working with whatever smart people around you you can find, is get through at least A, B, and C. We'll talk in a little bit, but engage in some conversation. Two brains are better than one. Three brains might even be better than that. And if you guys could log into class, that would be great. I think we're going to go with the strategy of the last person to log in is the one that we're going to just play.
What did I come here and do?
What are you doing?
Yes, I'm in.
I see that Stephen and Carmen and Celeste are logged in. Now, of course, Giselle can't be logged in since I have her calculator.
Why is it working? My mic is closed.
Now, I don't know if anybody had this experience this morning, but when you turned on your calculator, if that little blue progress bar was showing up, that is the sign that your calculator is resetting itself. It's resetting itself to factory standard, meaning you might be back in degree mode, meaning you might be back to like float 3 or something. Okay, we seem to get past that. I just have to hit the reset button. Okay. Shown below, or let's call it to the right, is drawn in the xy plane and is described by the equation of polar coordinates r equals theta plus sine 2 theta for 0 less than or equal to theta less than or equal to pi, where r is measured in meters and theta is measured in radians. Okay? Such a kind question on the part of the College Board. They don't need you to know what the graph looks like, they give it to you. You need to know how to graph this on your calculator. Or my calculator is the case. Fixing her calculator, I have no idea who got in last.
I
leads him over to the other one.
Steven, if you could make sure that we're set up so you can see both boards at the same time. Theta plus sine 2 theta, and the first question, they want an expression for dr d theta. Don't overthink this. Dr d theta, they're asking for one thing and one thing only. Polynomial, what are they asking for here?
The derivative of theta plus sine of 2 theta.
Right, they want the derivative of r with respect to theta, which means go find r, okay, and go find the derivative. And the derivative of theta plus sine 2 theta?
Cos 2 theta. Two cosine of theta.
Don't agree with you. What I heard you say is it's going to be cosine of 2 theta times 2, and I don't 100% agree. What's wrong?
One.
The derivative of theta with respect to theta, think like x, right? The derivative of x is 1. So that's the derivative. Done? Easy peasy. Okay. Part B, there is a point in the first quadrant where r equals theta plus sine 2 theta has a vertical tangent. Vertical tangent in the first quadrant. What would have to be true? Something really important has to be true if you have a vertical tangent line. I see one person. I see two. Celeste, what has to be true if you have a vertical tangent?
Dy d theta can equal 0 and dx d theta has to be equal.
Right, it's a two-part argument, and so Ale, we're definitely going to need your help here. So if you have a vertical tangent line, in the world of rectangular, you'd say something like dy dx is undefined. But in polar, whenever we talk about dy dx, what we really mean is it's dy d theta divided by dx d theta. So if dy dx is undefined, it's because the denominator is equal to 0 and the numerator is not equal to 0. So what you need is dx d theta equals 0, but dy d theta is not equal to 0. How are we going to figure out where dx d theta is equal to 0? So the problem with the calculator, Ale, if you can get me over to the graph. Okay, and then you need to graph that polar curve. So theta. Theta plus sine 2 theta. Okay, it's been a while. Theta plus sine 2 theta. I have confidence she's going to get it this time. Oh, God. Oh, God.
That's right.
Okay, right. I think we're having some lag time, maybe. I'm not really sure what's going on there.
I don't need to call that lag.
I think the word is crash and burn. All right, Palomon, new plan.
What?
You come back here.
No,
Danny, even when you try to.
Okay. All right. Yep. Oh my God! Come on now, grab. And we're going to go to menu, and we're going to go to graph entry, we're going to go to polar, we're going to go to theta.
Yeah.
Theta. Plus sine 2 theta. This is not the way I saw this lesson going. Okie dokie. There we go. So I just graphed theta plus sine 2 theta, and I got that as my graph. And I hope everybody realizes that we have a problem here. There's an obvious problem here. Look at the graph. Look at the graph on your paper. There's a problem here.
It doesn't come back.
It's not supposed to loop back around over here. Why is my graph doing that? It has to do, it kind of has to do with the window setting. Read the problem one more time.
It's from
0
to pi.
From 0 to pi. The way that you're going to fix it, so go back over here and hit the tab. And we haven't spent a lot of time looking down here, but you've got this set up to go from 0 to 6.28, which is 2 pi. You just want to go from 0 to pi. So, Palamon, you're going to go down to where the 6.28 is. And just delete that fun stuff out of there. And then just type in pi. And if you could close out all those email messages that are popping up, that would be great. From 0 to pi. And then maybe put a little space in there. There you go, hit enter. Everybody okay?
Whoa.
We got the right graph now? Things are matching? All right. So, but here's the problem. I still have to figure out where dx d theta is equal to 0. The real problem is what the heck is dx d theta? The way that we're going to find dx d theta, what we know is r, and we found dr d theta really quickly. How do I get to dx d theta? You have to first tell me what x is. X is r cosine theta, which means that this is theta plus the sine of 2 theta times cosine theta. And, well, no, that this is just the radius times cosine theta.
Oh, yes.
Okay, and then Celeste, what is it that you said?
The derivative equals 1 plus 2 cosine of 2 theta times cosine
1 plus 2 cosine of 2 theta.
Times cosine of theta.
Times cosine of theta.
Plus. Theta.
Theta.
Plus sine 2 theta.
Plus sine 2 theta.
Times negative sine theta.
Times negative sine theta. Right, where did all this mess come from? Product rule. We had the radius times the cosine, derivative of the first, leave the second alone, plus the first times the derivative of the second. I am confident that on this problem they would award 1 point for even knowing that you need to look for x equals r cosine theta, possibly 2 points for finding the derivative. Now the fun part, where is this equal to 0? You have your calculator for a reason. Right? The only thing that you need to do to figure out where this guy is equal to 0, graph it, find the root. Now, although this is in polar, what we're looking for is the angle. So, Paloma, what I'm going to ask you to do is hit menu. And rather than entering this in polar, we're going to enter it as a function. So just go to graph, entry, edit, select function, and then type in all this stuff, but instead of theta, x. So 1 plus 2 cosine 2x times cosine x plus blah, 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 blah. Get that all typed in and find out where it's equal to 0. So 1 plus 2
theta.
We're going to graph it as a function.
Okay.
Because what we're looking for is the roots. We're looking for it's going to cross the x-axis. Okay, but Palamon, you need parentheses.
Yeah.
And you also need to start with 1 plus 2 cosine of 2x.
Oh, yeah, no.
There you go. So parentheses over there. parentheses after the cosine 2x polynomial.
Yeah.
And then times cosine of x, that's good. Plus, now just like I wrote it over here, open parentheses, x plus sine 2x. Open parentheses, because we're typing in this part. X plus sine 2x. It's been a while, I know. Oh my God, we're dying. We're just dying here. So while Palamon does that, I might have a conversation with someone near you about part C and what your plan is there.
Times, okay, another one?
Times negative sine of x. Okay, except Palamon, you need that times negative sine of x to start outside the parentheses, so delete the negative x. And that parentheses. Yep. And the dot. Outside, hit times. Or not.
Negative sign.
We need negative sign. You need to be times negative sign. Times, yep, the multiplication dot, negative.
Negative, homie.
Okay, Palamon, you're not doing this on purpose, right?
What?
Enter.
Okay, is anybody else getting a graph that looks like this?
I think you still left the negative.
I don't care anymore. Does anybody have a graph that looks like this?
No, it looks smoother.
It looks a little bit smoother. Okay, but here's the thing. What is it that we're looking for?
The root.
We're looking for the root, not just any root, because you've got 1, 2, 3 roots showing up here. It's not just any root that you're looking for. It's a very specific root that we're looking for.
And the interval from 0 to pi.
From 0 to 0 to pi or 0 to pi over 2?
Pi.
From 0 to pi. So that's like 0 to like 3.1 and some change. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be this guy over here. Whatever this root happens to be, can somebody please find that root?
You do not.
Okay. Is it 0.69? Okay, except we need to fix the decimal precision because it shouldn't be 0.69. So just hit menu.
0.69.
Yeah, get out of flip mode. Fix 3. Or fix 4. That's fine. Make default. Yes. Click OK. Yes. 0.6899. Oh, thank God. Okay. So this is going to be true at theta is approximately 0.6899. All right, we're going to adjust the plan here. We're going to jump to part E. No, D. Part D. Find the value of dy d theta at theta equals pi over 4. Interpret the meaning of your answer. And you don't get to use your calculator. Palamon, thank you for everything that you're doing over there. Sine 2 theta times 2 times sine of theta, derivative of the first part, leave the second one alone, plus theta sine 2 theta times cosine theta. Is everybody okay with the derivative part? Okay. You've got to know the transformation equation. You got to know how to find the derivative. Next part. You're going to evaluate at pi over 4. We're going to be really careful about the notation here. So 1 plus cosine 2 times pi over 4 is pi over 2. Multiply all that by 2. Times the sine of pi over 4 plus pi over 4 plus the sine of 2 times pi over 4, that's going to be pi over 2, times cosine of pi over 4. Now, how much simplifying do we need to do? This is the free response part of the test. As long as everything here is a number, you don't need to do anything at all. Cosine of pi over 2 is a number. It is a number that you're supposed to know, but it's a number. Sine of pi over 4, sine of pi over 2, they're all numbers. You are fine stopping here. Unless they ask you to do something. And the question is, like, now that you found ui d theta at theta equals pi over 4, what does this tell you about the curve? What does it tell you about what the curve is doing? Why would we ever look at dy d theta? That's a derivative. You're talking about how the y value changes with respect to theta. You need to know, is the particle going, or is the curve increasing in the vertical direction or decreasing in the vertical direction? So guess what? We need to figure out, is this positive or is it negative? So let's do it. We're going to have to evaluate. But I think there's some good stuff happening. Cosine of pi over 2? Cosine of pi over 2 is 0 times 2. Sine of pi over 4? Is square root of 2 over 2 plus pi over 4 sine of pi over 2
1
is going to be 1 cosine of pi over 4 is the square root of 2 over 2. Is there anything that we know for certain about this expression? Has to be positive, right? Positive, 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 positive. The whole thing is positive. The conclusion? Therefore, when theta equals pi over 4, now you're going to be really careful. At this time, what do we know? What I heard somebody say was, we're increasing. But you have to be specific. There's four different derivatives that we talk about. Dx d theta, dy d theta, dy dx, dr d theta. When theta is equal to pi over 4, something's increasing. Dy is not increasing. The y value is increasing, which means you're going up. As your angle increases, the y value gets bigger, bigger, bigger. Okay. So when theta equals pi over 4, I'd say something like the y value is increasing. Or you could say the curve is increasing vertically, something like that. Is everybody mostly okay? Mm-hmm. Mostly. Okay. All right, part F. Find the area bounded by the curve and the x-axis. Polynome, we're back to you. So, Polynome, if you could get us back, you can delete f1 of x. And all I want to see is the original polar curve. So yeah, if you want to click on F1 and just hit delete. No, F1, there you go, and delete. Oh, that didn't work.
Try
the curve and now delete. Or you can unclick the box, or you could do that too. You could just unclick the box. you really You really could, Palamon. Just hit tab. No, no. No, Palamon.
Go to four.
Go to four.
Arrow up. Unclick the box.
Crazy.
Whoa.
Lots of lessons being learned here today. Find the area bounded by the curve and the x-axis. Curve and the x-axis. It's all I want. Area bounded by the curve and the x-axis. I want all this stuff. Area is going to be 1/2, integrating from a starting point to an ending point. R squared d theta, that's the formula. Plug this stuff in. Do we know what the radius is?
Yes.
Absolutely. Do we know our starting value? Yes. All right, we're going to start at theta equals 0. Do we know the ending value? Yes. All right, remember, in polar, you start at 0 and think about a windshield wiper. Think about how that windshield wiper is moving. You're going to start off, and at pi over 2, you're up here. You got to keep on going to sweep all the way through that region. And so you should go from theta equals 0 to theta equals pi. Everybody okay? Mm-hmm. All right, so Palamon, with the graph still on there, let's go back over to the calculate version. And 1/2. And then you want to integrate. So menu, calculus, numerical integral, and we're going to go from 0 to pi. Okay, now you need to be careful because, yeah, it's going to have to be R1, not F1, because this is what your radius is, R1 of theta. You've got to make sure that you square it. And we're integrating with respect to theta. And we hit a 4.382.
Are you sure for this time?
You what?
Are you sure for this time?
Okay.
Small victories today.
Yep. Teeny, teeny tiny ones. Everybody go to 4.382? Really, I just need you to have faith that this is the formula that I'm not going to lie to you. Okay, we derived it before the break. Don't need you to worry about deriving it. I do, however, need you to be able to apply it in different ways. So this is the last one that we're going to do. Consider a circle of radius 1 centered at the origin. Set up, but do not evaluate, an integral which can be expressed, used to determine the area in the first quadrant, which is inside the circle, and inside the curve. I want you to go back to the graph and zoom in a little bit. I'm going to let you guys dangle on this a little bit. Zoom in a little bit so that the curve fills up a little bit more of the space. Nice. Okay. So what are we trying to accomplish?
The first quadrant.
In the first quadrant, something else has changed. There's something else going on in this problem. You've got a circle of radius 1. So that's going to be, it looks like the scale is something. So there's your circle.
Okay.
There's your circle of radius 1.
Okay.
In polar, that's R equals 1. Before you do anything else, shade in what the region is that we're actually looking for. Consider a circle of radius 1 centered at the origin. Set up, but don't evaluate, an integral expression which can be used to determine the area in the first quadrant, which is inside the circle and at the same time inside r equals theta plus sine 2 theta. It's going to do both things at the same time. It's going to live in the first quadrant. Okay, it looks like everybody's got the right region. We're looking for this part right here. How would we find the area in polar? What are your thoughts? We're working in polar. Think about the windshield wipers here. They're not rectangles anymore. It's the windshield wiper method. Palamon, you get some thoughts?
That's kind of...
We're going to stay in terms of theta.
There's a couple of different ways we could approach this,
but what you want is this region over here, and think about that windshield wiper. When I first start, that windshield wiper is telling me that I'm supposed to stay on this curve right here. What's the radius there? Like right here or right there, how would I find the radius on this part of the curve? That part of the curve is my original function, the r equals theta plus sine 2 theta. So we're going to start off with an area and say, okay, it's going to be 1 half. We're going to integrate. What we're going to integrate is theta plus sine 2 theta squared d theta. Where do I start integrating? I'm going to start at 0. Where do I stop integrating? Now, if I go to pi over 2, what you're saying is use this curve all the way from 0 to pi over 2 to find the area. If you do that, you're going to find that area. Celeste. Carmen. Sorry.
We just stop where when the two graphs intersect.
What you actually need to do is you need to stop at the intersection point. You need to stop at the angle, because you start integrating at 0, and you go until you hit whatever this magic angle is. Because that's going to give you the area for this wedge below that line segment. So what you need to do is figure out what's the angle. What's so special about this angle is that at this particular angle, the original curve and the circle have the exact same radius. So what we need is we need r such that theta plus the sine of 2 theta is equal to 1. And unfortunately, in the world of polar, when your calculator is in polar mode, you cannot find intersection points. It doesn't do any of the stuff.
0.3523 radians.
Point what?
3523 radians.
3523. How did you get 0.3523?
I hit trace.
You hit trace. Okay, maybe you want to trace. What I would hope would be better is that you would actually graph this on your calculator as a function, and then graph the line y equals 1 and see where they intersect. David, hi there. Either way, I'm going to call this point A. And that means we're going to integrate from 0 to theta equals A. What that gets you is the area for this little wedge down here. Now you're not done, because what you needed is the rest of the region. Well, how do I get that area? I'm going to do another area expression. It's going to be 1 half the integral. Well, where do I start? I start at theta equals a. I integrate until I end at pi over 2. And what's the radius for that part? Starting at theta equals a, and we're going to pi over 2, but the curve that I'm interested in now is the circle. So it's going to be 1 squared d theta. Okay. We've got a lot of work to do in the world of polar this week. We've got 3 days to practice. Tonight's homework is assignment 131. I need you to get done all the multiple choice questions and free response question number 5. For sure this is getting picked up tomorrow. For sure, for sure, for sure. You should be ready to do all the parts. Yes, please.
Oh yeah, you forgot your backpack.